Just behind me is the area that's been allocated to native grass production. And as it looks a bit bare, as you can see, this is because in April we went through and did a cool burn, which is one of the traditional ways of managing country up on Gomeroi areas. There's a whole lot of dirt and white rocks you can see here. This is because the flood came through. And that's one of the things of being able to understand land management. We must listen to the elders and listen to the custodians, and also listen to other knowledge holders from different backgrounds to understand this isn't just a simple thing. This isn't just country that you can do one thing to and it behaves itself. Country changes all the time. It doesn't respond to just one input. There are thousands and thousands of inputs coming from different places, weather, climate, and also the plants, the animals, the insects, the soil biota, as well as the human management factor. So what we're looking at looks bare at the moment, but when it comes to spring, we're going to sow it with some of the grass species that we've identified in this project as probably the ones that are going to do the best physically when they're growing, but also the ones that have the most market potential. Being able to marry those two together alongside listening to country and listening to people is what will make this system sustainable economically, environmentally, and socially. One of the key words to understand when thinking about this system is the word monoculture. So the way that most crops are produced is in a monoculture, which means one species across several hectares or hundreds of hectares. And this has implications for the way that it's managed. So if you've got only one species, you can use bulk handling techniques, bulk application of a fertilizer or a herbicide, or if you're doing it organically, bulk application of techniques to that whole area over both time and seasons. But the traditional Aboriginal way on Gomeroi country of managing temperate areas was looking at diversity. So it was a real ecosystem where food of many different species, of many different heights, of shapes, of sizes, of colours, were all used to produce different types of food from the same area at the same time. So behind me, I mean, these are grasses here. These are all winter or spring flowering grasses. But there's all these other species. There's low growing ones. There's trees. This is an open woodland here. There's flowers down here on the ground, beautiful wild flowers of many different species. Some edible, some not. But country like this would have been managed to encourage the edible species to produce food if this was a part of land that was designated for that purpose. And this is very different to the way that modern crops are produced. And the modern technologies that we have, the equipment, the machines, are adapted to being able to manage monocultures. When you're doing things in diverse systems like this, you need to do a lot more things by hand because there's different heights, different shapes and sizes, different times of year that things happen. And so you really need the human brain and the human hand to be able to apply things like picking, like management, like identifying what's an edible one and what's a poisonous one, all these sorts of things. And so trying to bring back the original way of producing food on Gomeroi country, which integrates not just grains, but also herbs, also fruits, and salad greens from the same physical area of land, is very different to the way that we would do it in a European style of agricultural system. Not impossible, but in a modern context, economically, doing it that way is quite expensive because of the number of people that have to be involved in doing things by hand. So consideration of the plant height, for example, seems something that's so simple. But if you've got grain that's this height as well as one that's that height, if you come through with machines, which height is the machine going to be set at? Which grain is it going to collect? And what does that mean for the end product consistency? We're down here now, not far away from the native grains plots, just on the other side of the tree over there. But I wanted to show you some of the examples of what a more modern grassland might look like that hasn't been managed for thousands of years in the traditional way. So what we're looking at now is a fairly degraded pasture. This had a flood across it about about 6 months ago. And then before that, it had been a degraded pasture for several decades. And it had a drought just before the flood. So there's plenty of weeds in here. But there's also some diversity. A lot of what I'm going to show you now, these are the winter growing species. So it'll look quite different at different times of year. But just to show you, so there are some burrs, some weeds like this, different types of grasses, some dead, some alive. Some of this is the stuff that grew in summer and has now died off. But then in between it, you'll see the young plants germinating, different ones that are edible, not edible, good for humans, good for stock. There's a real mix. And this type of degraded pasture and open woodland is very common on Gomeroi country. And if we're going to bring back the native grain system, we need to understand what it looks like now and what it might take to be able to remove some of the bad bits and reintroduce some of the good bits that we want, that are the edible native species. Many of these edible species are not particularly vigorous, which means they don't compete very well, particularly when they're young, with the introduced weeds and even some of the other species that are dominant at the moment. So over there, you'll see different types of grasses, different species, a real mix. And the idea is being able to decide, how are we going to change something that looks quite diverse like this into something that's both diverse but also more functional, that produces the grains that we want, the grains that are significant for people, for food, for country, whilst also being able to provide those environmental benefits and diversity benefits and carbon credit benefits that we know can come out of this system. Here's an example of what something might look like when it comes in from the field. This is mostly Mitchell grass. You can see there that there's most of it's still in its husk or in its glumes, and Lemma and Palea are all still within it. Then if you run this through a machine or do some manual threshing, you flick it aside, you can see what's come out. So these little orangey coloured seed, they're button grass, it's not actually Mitchell. The Mitchell are these yellowy kind of coloured seeds there. But it also shows a really good example of when you kind of look at it that comes in from the field, it looks like a bit of a mess. And you don't really notice, there's actually quite a lot of button grass in there. The button grass threshes a lot easier than the Mitchell. So that's a button grass piece there, that's a button grass piece there, and they thresh a lot easier than the Mitchell. So the majority of what you actually see is the button. But both of them are in there together. As we finish up, I just want to mention that what we're doing physically on university land here is only a real drop in the bucket in the bigger picture. And I'd like to acknowledge the support and partnership of Black Duck Foods, which is Bruce Pascoe and the Ewan mob that are working on native grains on their country. And also the TAFE, also our farming partners that have donated land, time, expertise. The agronomists that have advised on this project, and then the seed specialists and native ecosystem restoration specialists that are also involved in this work.